So the first test against Australia, now in Adelaide and not Brisbane, are starting on Tuesday. Lots to talk about, obviously, vis-a-vis both the teams, the test itself, cricket itself, of course. But I suppose we've somewhat moved on from the Phil Hughes incident, and it's down to the cricket. And Mitchell Marsh, Dilip, I'll start with you. Mitchell Johnson, I beg your pardon. Talking about how when it comes to what happens on the field, nothing's changed. Everything is exactly the way it was. Of course, the players have needed time to get over what happened and have found their own ways of dealing with it. But when it comes to game time, it's exactly how things were.
Yeah, and for India, that means, you know, going back 60 years, just 5 test wins on Australian soil. To use Steve Waugh speak, it remains very much the final frontier. And you think about the fact that in 2003, 4 and 7, 8, when India went with the strongest batting lineup they've ever had, they still couldn't win the series on either of those occasions.
They came close.
They came close, but close doesn't quite cut it when it comes to winning. So, given that, and the fact that I'm sure quite a few of the Australians will be inspired by the need to pay tribute to Philip Hughes on the field, it's the sternest test possible, I think, for this Indian team.
He's the 13th man of that squad. A brilliant way to pay tribute also. I think all of them are also got the number on their shirts, Suresh. When it comes to just bringing the two matters together, bouncers very much a part of both stories, the test series coming up and the Phil Hughes incident. And would you say that this is as good a chance as India's ever had in terms of their pace attack to match the Australians, pace for pace, bounce for bounce, or the Australians are still ahead?
Well, we'd like to believe that, but I think that's slightly forlorn hope, because Australia are playing at home, they have the more experienced pace attack, and Indians haven't really, whenever they've had a pace attack, they've never really been in that class at any time, and all these years that we know that Dilip was talking about. The fact is that there is a problem with the idea of taking 20 wickets, and it's important that they did not lose the first test match. And over a long period, whenever we've travelled, we've tended to lose the first test match, and that is,
you know, in that sense, it's not a bad thing for India that it's starting in Adelaide.
It's not a bad thing for India that it's starting in Adelaide. It's not a bad thing for India that the focus is not so much on them right now, which I think is another advantage. And the fact that there is a new captain, the fact that India are not really expected to win, at least in my book, I don't think they're expected to win, and certainly not win the first test match. I think it kind of reduces the pressure, and that might just be the sort of turning point. Maybe that's the element they need. But to imagine that bouncers will not figure, I think, is a bit simplistic.
We'll talk about the Australians in a bit, more about the Australians in a bit, Dilip. This Indian team, very low on experience. In the first test, there's no Dhoni either. You do have Ishant Sharma with 58 tests, but no one really takes that very seriously. Virat Kohli, the captain, not yet 30 test matches. Ashwin, maybe the other somewhat experienced player, but really lack of experience. Ordinarily, that's not the sort of team you'd choose to take to Australia.
Ordinarily, no, but some of these players, in fact, several of these players have been on top-end tours with for the emerging trophy.
The 18 tours.
And they've been on 18 tours. I don't think this is a generation that's easily overawed by overseas conditions. They can be found out, as we saw in England in the final 3 tests, but they also produced that one remarkable performance at Lord's, which I think is perhaps India's best victory in England ever. So, I don't think you should write them off completely because of that lack of experience, because there are enough players in this side who've shown signs away from home, whether that's Kohli in South Africa, Rahane in New Zealand and South Africa, or Pujara in South Africa last year. So there are promising signs, but like Suresh said, without those 20 wickets, all of that comes to naught.
One more question to you before moving to Suresh, Dilip. Virat Kohli talking about aggression. Now, he's a very different captain from MS Dhoni, on the evidence of what we have seen, primarily in limited overs cricket. Extremely difficult, so different. So how does it work for the team, from your experience, where a set of players play a particular way under MS Dhoni and are expected to change their style of play or their approach more than anything else, their attitude under Kohli for one test?
I don't think there'll be a huge change in approach or attitude. See, the basic thing about leadership is that you need to have a captain or a leader that you can trust, who you believe is worthy of captaining you. And I think whether that's Dhoni or Kohli, they've earned that position. And I don't think there'll be any difficulty regardless of what the message is from the man in charge. If Virat says, I want more passion on the field, I'm sure he'll get that. The bottom line is that you need to command respect, and I don't think you'll have difficulty doing that.
Just taking an experience question to you, Suresh. In the past, we've seen first-time fast bowlers from India and Australia sort of get excited with the bounce and the pace and offer, often spray the ball around a bit, bowl too many bouncers, which might work against a domestic team in the Ranji Trophy, but not against players who have grown up on those pitches. Is that a fear still, or like Dilip is saying, people are more aware of these things? It's not like a kid will go there and Varun Aaron and get extremely excited by the bounce on offer. They've visited those places with the A team and other teams.
That's quite true, but this again, as I said earlier, this again is a hope, because despite experience or despite initial experience at many of these conditions, Indian bowlers have tended to get a little excited when the track allows them to do things that they cannot do in India. So it's a human situation, and they need to choose between between giving in to that or sticking to what they know best as a professional. And I think this is where someone like Ravi Shastri might play a useful role, because he's done the hard yards, he's been around for some time, and he can get his message across. And I think that's an important part of sort of guiding. And I think Virat Kohli, to come back to your earlier question, I think both Virat Kohli as well as Dhoni will benefit from having that kind of advice with them.
If I could just add to that, I think the big difference on this tour is the depth in the fast bowling reserves. I remember in 1999-2000 when India lost miserably 3-0, the first day of the series, India had Australia, I think, 3-50. But there was just Srinath and Prasad. There was not really that third bowler to drive home the advantage. So you had to go back to consolidation mode, which doesn't really work against good teams. Here, I think you will have that third bowler who's well capable of taking wickets, provided, as Suresh said, that they stick to the basics, remember to pitch the ball up and not get carried away.
And while on the subject of the Indian team, let's quickly hear your predictions as far as the composition of the 11 will be. What are your thoughts on it?
I would love to see five bowlers play.
But what do you think is going to happen?
I think they might stick to four. But
that's 3-1?
I think so. Very little chance of two spinners playing in Australia, because even Adelaide, the nature of the pitch has changed a lot with it becoming a drop-in pitch. So I don't think you'll see square turn at any stage during any of the four tests.
No, not many fifth bowlers in that squad, in that Indian potential 11.
Which is why I think 3+2 would possibly have made more sense, because I think Ashwin is good enough as a batsman to hold down the number 7 spot if required. And at the end of the day, you need those 20 wickets. So if you give yourself 5 bowlers, you're giving yourself a better chance of getting those 20 wickets.
In agreement, Suresh?
I think so. Ideally, you should go with 5 bowlers. But what will happen, I think, is they'll go with 4, because they cannot afford to lose the first test and then be virtually out of the
series. Catching up afterwards, yeah. What about the Australians then? They do have two pretty decent medium-pace all-rounders in Shane Watson and Mitchell Marsh.
Exactly. So to that extent, they're certainly better placed. This is the unfortunate thing about the Indian team, is that they don't have a batsman who is a good enough bowler to either take wickets or hold up one end, keep one end going. They just don't have that kind of an all-rounder.
Looking at the Australians, Suresh, what do you make of the way they look? Of course, the last time they played Test cricket, they didn't look too good. Michael Clarke certainly not looking good at all, whether on the field or off the field, the past few days. So what do you make of the way they look on the whole from the outside before this first test?
Well, I think misfortune often brings a group together, and that might well be the case with Australia. I mean, Clarke has been emotionally distraught over the last many days, and this might just be the sort of thing that brings the team together. I mean, Clarke himself was in some doubt initially about playing the test. This is before
the delay must have helped him a bit.
Yes, and now he's determined to, and they're all going to say we're going to do it for Husey, and that kind of thing does you know, add the extra yard or add the extra, you know, ability to score or whatever, and that does, that will make a difference. India's chance, certainly the first test, because I keep saying this because we've tended to lose the first test of an away series, and then it's been very difficult. And India's best chance really is, I mean, from the Indian point of view, is that they would go with four bowlers. Although this would be the, I mean, sort of counterintuitively, this would be the ideal situation in which they go with five bowlers, because this is where you can put pressure on Australia, because you don't know. I mean, it's all very well sitting here and saying that, you know, the misfortune might bring the team together, but it might just, you know, not do that, in which case this is your best chance to sort of put pressure on the Australians. So it could cut either way, and it's a decision that has to be taken with some thought.
The Australians, there's of course the World Cup and the Ashes lined up after that, but, and we've talked endlessly in various contexts, Dilip, about most teams doing well at home and not away, and Australia, like we were just discussing, didn't do well in the UAE, but not looking as good as you'd probably expect them to, hosting India ahead of a big season with Michael Clarke iffy in terms of his fitness, Chris Rogers not in great form of late, Brad Haddin coming back from an injury, Ryan Harris after a long layoff. So kind of iffy in terms of their overall appearance.
No, which is why I would have loved to see five bowlers play, because you've got...
So every reason, according to the two of you, to have five bowlers.
Because you've got Chris Rogers at the top of the order under severe pressure. Stephen
You'd
Smith,
probably have had Phil Hughes there as one
exactly,
of the contenders.
Stephen Smith is still relatively new to Test cricket. David Warner is the only one who's shown signs of steady form even in the UAE. Clark's back problem, you don't know where he is really with that. How much of it is mind over matter in terms of getting out on the park. Ryan Harris coming back from
his serious
knee surgery. Shane Watson as well. So there are plenty of question marks over that side. Can Mitchell Johnson maintain that incredible form of the last 12 months? So all of these things are up in the air to an extent, and a brave side would try to, you know, work on those weaknesses by maybe playing the fifth bowler.
Quick question. Is Kohli more likely to play that fifth bowler than Dhoni, or it's not up to him at all?
I don't think it'll be completely up to him, because Dhoni is in Adelaide and I'm sure he'll be very much part of the decision-making process in terms of selecting the team. Duncan Fletcher's there, Ravi Shastri's there, they'll value his inputs as well. So let's wait and see, but you know, I'd love to see those five bowlers.
So would you.
Absolutely.
Unlikely to see them though, that's the problem, at least sitting on the outside, we don't know what's really going on in Adelaide, whether there is enough talk of possibly having that fifth bowler, just throwing in a fifth bowler and seeing how things go. Of course, the stakes are a lot higher for Virat Kohli and the rest of the team than it is for us as far as the outcome of this test match is concerned. For the moment, thanks a lot, Suresh and Dilip. We'll keep talking as this series progresses and more talking points crop up.